Okay, so we're now going to look at the case of an overdamped system when the value of the damping factor D exceeds 1. When the damping factor is very large, the system essentially becomes more and more unresponsive. So it's what's called overdamped. We went too far. And we can think of this as a guitar where the guitar string has kind of a cloth paste on it, or you're putting a hand on top of it, so when you pluck it, it really doesn't do much. To understand that, again, we will go back to the Laplace transform of the output for a unit step input, which is given by k omega square over s times s square plus 2d omega s plus omega square. And, you know, now we don't have any tricks to play. In terms of the denominator, we really have to bite the bullet and expand it out properly. So we recognize that this is a quadratic in S, and so it is the roots of this can be expressed as minus 2 d omega plus minus b square is 4 omega square d square minus 4ac, so that's 4 omega square by 2a, so that's 2. So these are the roots. And so given this, the partial fraction expansion turns out to be a bit messy, but this is what it is. So ys is, we're going to replace the roots by k omega square over, we're just going to rewrite this in terms of its roots, s times s plus d omega plus omega square root d square minus 1 and s plus d omega minus omega square root d square minus 1. So this is the partial, this is just substituting the roots over here. If we go ahead and expand it using partial fraction, let gamma be square root of d square minus 1, and then we will find that yt, and this is a tedious, but it's relatively straightforward, there's really nothing special, it's 1 plus e to the minus d plus gamma omega t over 2 gamma e plus d plus gamma, 2 gamma please plus gamma minus e to the minus d minus gamma omega t over 2 gamma d minus gamma. So if you look at this carefully, what you'll find is that this is the steady state response. And then these two are just exponential. So these denominators are really independent of time. These are just some constants because D is the dampening value. It's some number over here. Gamma is some other number related to D. And so these just become constants, which can be removed. And then this becomes of the form e to the minus alpha t, and this is e to the minus beta t. So it's the difference between two exponentials. So if you think about it, one looks like this, e to the minus alpha t, or if you want a e to the minus alpha t, and the other one is sort of b e to the minus beta t. And so the gap between them also is exponential, and we're subtracting all of that, we're adding all of that to 1. And so the graph for this looks something like this. We, depending on the value of d, when d is 1, we're going to get this rise over here. And as we make d larger and larger, it gets further and further away from its asymptotic value. So the asymptotic value is going to be here, k equals 2.5. k equals 2.5. And so as we increase the value of damping, it rises to the final value slower and slower again, slower and slower. So the intuition is that what we want the system to do essentially is for it to achieve its asymptotic value k. And what's happening is that when we underdamp it, it reaches the value but overshoots it. It goes beyond it, and then it goes to the other side, and then it eventually settles down to its final value. And so when you underdamp it too much, it's swinging too much before it gets to the final value. As we increase the dampening ratio, it gets nicely damped, closer and closer. And when we damp it exactly at D equals 1 or zeta equals 1, it's going to rise perfectly nicely and get there. But when we overdamp it, it takes longer and longer. So we have sort of this problem of how to choose dampening. So if you choose damping too large, we're going to take too long to get to the final value. And if it takes too small, it's going to oscillate before it gets to the final value. And so the goal, our goal is to choose damping to be just right. Unfortunately, the just right value depends a lot on system parameters. And so there's a certain amount of trial and error that you need to do in a second order system to compute the right value of the damping factor. So to summarize, in a second order system, we have three parameters to play with. We have the gain, which is eventually the scalar value that you're going to be getting. The damping value, which is we're calling D or zeta. And the damping value tells us how quickly we achieve the final gain value. And then omega, the natural frequency omega. And the natural frequency tells us this is what the system really wants to do. The system really likes to be oscillating at the natural frequency. That's its way of being. And if we don't damp it, it's just going to oscillate at this natural frequency. That's what's going to happen. This is the behavior of the system when it's in a unmodified state. And what we want to do is to convert the system, which has this natural frequency, into a system which actually behaves like this. When you give it a step input, it rises, and then all the oscillatory behavior completely goes away. And this is achieved by damping the system properly. So the analogy that I can use over here is, imagine that you're on a bicycle, and you're riding a bike, and you want to press the brakes to stop. If you underdamp the system, it's like pressing the brakes too lightly, and what's going to happen is that the brake shoe will actually just oscillate at the natural frequency, which is being from the excitement of the wheel rubbing against it, which is the excitement given by the energy transferred to it. It'll just vibrate. And if you press too hard, what will happen is that you're basically going to fall off the bike. You overdamped it. And the critical damping is when it just slows down and stops just as you like it to be. So that's not necessarily a perfect analogy, but it gives you a sense of what kind of system we're looking at over here.